Okay, let's talk about heat treating. When you're new, or even intermediate, this is one of those really daunting subjects. When you first get into knife making and read some of the forum posts and people talking all about these fancy terms, Martensite, Austenite, perlite, it's really confusing. So I figured I'd put together this video and help you guys understand these terms and what to do. Just a note on units. I'll be talking in Fahrenheit, but all the slides have both Celsius and Fahrenheit. So we want martensite. That's hardened steel. But it's important to know these two terms. We're not talking about these martens. They're cool though. Steel has a crystalline structure, and martensite is the state where steel is hardened. And of course, that's the one we want. But we need to figure out how to get there, and austenite is the key. It's the state of the steel right before you quench. You need to reach these austenizing temperatures. You're going to hear that term a lot. Austenite is the state of the steel before we quench. So austenite before martensite, not to be confused with an Aston Martin. This is always a debatable topic. Do I really need a heat treating oven? I get that not everyone has an oven, and a lot of stuff I'm going to talk about later, especially when we get to recipes, is going to assume an oven. But first, let's talk about heat treating in a forge, since that's what most of you are probably going to do. Forges are great, but the toughest part about a forge is managing accurate heat, particularly managing it for longer periods, like 10 minutes or more. It's possible to have a PID controller installed, which is a proportional integral derivative controller. Yes, I had to look that up. That's basically a temperature gauge inside your forge, and it will control the gas and air mixture. They're kind of pricey, and at that point, you might as well just buy an oven, in my opinion, unless you need the forge for other reasons. Let's talk about tips and tricks for heat treating using a forge. If you're going to heat treat in a forge, there's a bunch of things you need to know. Everyone kind of gets this one, the magnetism effect. Steel loses its magnetic properties around 1425 Fahrenheit. Most of the knife steels we use need to be quenched at 475. So I hear a lot of people say, I just need to go to non-magnetic and quench. Well, you're about 50 degrees off, and that makes a major difference. You really need to go to non-magnetic and a little further. Another really important aspect here is that while steel loses its magnetism at 1425, sometimes it doesn't gain it back until it goes back under 500 degrees. Sometimes people put a blade in and out of the forge and keep testing it, and they may think it's non-magnetic, but parts of it may have cooled. But it hasn't gained its magnetism back. So be really careful of this, folks. There are other ways that are a little more accurate than using a magnet. Salt happens to melt at 1474 degrees, which is almost exactly where you want to quench a lot of the steels, like 10 series steels, 1080, 1084, 1095. So that's a really interesting effect. I've never actually done it personally because I got my oven before I learned this, but some of you might want to try that out. Another popular tip is to get a piece of steel pipe and put that in your forge and place the blade inside that and use it as a baffle. That will help you regulate the temperature quite a bit. Let's talk about the stages of working steel. There's a star beside the first few because even though you might not be doing them, they're being done on the steel. Someone is forging the steel at the mill and then annealing it. So if you're just doing stock removal, most people say you don't need to normalize and anneal it because it's coming that way from the mill. One thing to note, when we talk about heat treating steel, it really involves all these processes: normalizing, annealing, grain refinement, quenching, and tempering. Let's first talk about normalization. What is it and why do we do it? Normalizing is done right after forging, and it mainly removes the stresses imposed by the forging process. It improves the grain structure, which we'll talk about in a minute. It gets the steel in a state that's better for the annealing process. Steel has a crystalline structure. If you look at it under a microscope, you'll see this, some different compositions and structures. If the structures are large and non-uniform, the steel will be more brittle. If the structures are small and uniform, the steel will generally be stronger. Now let's talk about annealing. What this does is transform the steel to its softest state, and this is where you want for grinding or things like that. It makes the steel easier to grind and machine. And in order to do this, we're going to heat it to about 100 degrees Fahrenheit below its austenizing temperature. So if it was, say, 1095, for example, you would heat it to about 1375 Fahrenheit. Then, whether using a forge or heat treating oven, just turn off the heat and let it sit there and cool slowly in the forge or oven, usually about 12 hours. Alternatively, if you want to keep using your forge or oven, you can place your steel in a container of vermiculite and let it cool slowly like that. Why do grain refinement? Like I said previously, steel is a crystal, and the finer the crystal structure will have, the stronger the steel will be. You'll hear people say, "Oh, check out my grain structure," and they'll have a picture of a snapped blade. The picture on the right is a good one, and it shows you the difference between the states. The top one, which kind of looks like sugar, as opposed to the very bottom one that looks like flour. Obviously, we want the bottom one. After two grain refinement steps, you generally stop gaining anything. So how do we refine the grain? We're going to heat it below the austenizing temperature and let it cool in still air until it's black, until you can hold it with your hand. Many people use descending temperatures for grain refinement, but studies by Dr. Laren Thomas have shown that these don't help, and you should do them at the same temperature, below austenizing temp. As a recap, here are the steps for normalizing, annealing, and doing grain refinement process on a specific example. Here we're going to use 1095 steel. If you need a heat treating oven, a forge, or anything else when it comes to knife making, check out Maritime Knife Supply. They've got everything you need. There's a link down in the description. And now on to quenching. First off, if you're going to take anything away from this video, it's this slide. I see or read this all the time. I quench 1095 in canola oil and it works for me. That's one of those sayings that just irks me. It works for me. First off, how do you know it worked? Just that it skated a file? That only tells you your steel is probably above 60 HRC before tempering. That's not very informative. A difference of 1 or 2 HRC is a big deal. You could be off by as much as 5. If you're not using the right quench medium for the steel you're using, one of two things has happened. One, you've quenched the steel in a quench oil that's too fast, which means you probably have cracks in the blade from too much stress. They might be micro cracks that you can't even see. The other one is you've quenched it in a quench oil that's too slow. You're not getting the steel as hard as it could be. Yes, you could have gotten lucky on either of these cases and have no cracks and gotten the blade hard. But you don't know, do you? I hate mysteries. This is why it's so important to use the oil that matches the speed of the steel you're quenching. So guys, make sure you understand this. And this is why I have two kinds of quench oil. We're talking about carbon steels here. Stainless steels are generally quenched between aluminum plates and require an oven. We'll talk a bit more about those later. Here we're going to discuss quenching in oil. Soak time is another thing that you will encounter. Some steels require that it stays at the austenizing temperature for a period of time before you quench it, otherwise it won't fully harden. 1095 is a notorious example of this. This is particularly problematic in a forge, where it's difficult maintaining the temperature on a piece of steel. If you just leave it in the forge, it'll tend to heat up way past where you want it. Soaking in a forge takes experience. You need to fine-tune your forge temp. And that's a reason why we don't recommend 1095 to beginners. Obviously, this is trivial in an oven. And now onto the quenching process. It's generally best to preheat the oil. I know this sounds counterintuitive, but oil that's heated has less viscosity, it's thinner, and therefore it actually cools the steel quicker. So you want to preheat your oil, usually around 120 degrees Fahrenheit, depending on the oil. When your steel has reached its austenizing temperature, and has had enough soak time, you're going to remove the blade from the forge or oven and plunge it directly in the oil, usually point first, and agitate it vigorously, meaning move it up and down. This will knock off the bubbles and prevent what's called a vapor jacket from forming. Removing the bubbles allows fresh oil to contact the steel and cool it faster. And just a note, folks, if anyone ever tells you you should quench facing a certain direction, ignore them. That's a complete wives' tale. You'll want to leave the blade in the oil for at least 10 seconds, preferably 30. So let's talk about some quenching do's and don'ts. Obviously, the first one is a simple one. Have a fire extinguisher ready, just in case something happens. The next one can be seen on Fortune and Fire. Smith's quench for 3 seconds, pull it out of the oil, and check and think it's not hard. Leave it in the oil, folks. It takes some time for those crystals to change. I leave it in the oil for at least 30 seconds generally, just to be sure. Next, be ready to temper immediately. Have all your stuff ready. You should be ready to temper right after the quench. A quench blade is like glass, so you need to bring down that hardness. So now, what you shouldn't do. The first one here is another one you see on Fortune Fire. People creating a fireball because either their steel was way too hot going in, or they're pulling it out of the oil before it's done. Both are terrible. It's bad for your blade, bad for your quench oil, and most importantly, bad for your health and safety. The next one is testing too soon. Even a minute after the quench, the steel could still be transforming its crystalline structure. If you test right after the quench, it might still be soft and in transition. Just give it some time before you test it. We've already talked about using the wrong quenching. Obviously, don't drop your blade in the oil or on the floor. And lastly, don't put your blade on an anvil or other steel surface. Putting your blade on an anvil, which is usually cold steel, will make your blade warp as the anvil sucks the heat out of one side of it. Either hang it on a hook, which is the best way, or clamp it to something. Another thing, don't try to correct your warp in a blade now. Do this during temper. Doing it now has a huge chance of snapping it. We'll talk about how to fix a warp during the tempering step. Let's talk about hardness. Hardness in steel is measured on the Rockwell C scale. Knives generally range from the high 50s to low 60s. If the hardness is too low, you have to sharpen it more, but your blade will be tougher and less likely to chip. If the hardness is too high, it will stay sharper longer, but it's more likely to chip and break. Testing the hardness of your knife is crucial. Like it says here, I'm pretty tired of hearing it skated a file. Like we discussed, that doesn't tell you much. Standard high-quality Nicholson files are about 62 HRC. All that tells you is your blade is at least that high. If you're using cheap files, it could be lower. If that's all you have or you want to invest in, just accept that your product has some mystery to it. Better is using hardness files. Here's a picture of those. Hardness files are files specifically for testing hardness, and they're in 5-point increments. If you test with a 65 HRC file, you know your blade is higher than 65. Then they go down in 5-point increments from there to 45 HRC. At least this tells you scientifically within 5 HRC, because these are guaranteed to be the HRC as stated. Of course, the best method is to have an actual HRC tester. I have one of these in my shop, and it's a great tool to have. It will tell you within 0.5 of an HRC. They're pricey though, and they go from $1,300 well up into the multiple thousands. So next is the temper. Why do we temper? Since the quench blade is going to be like glass, if you drop it on the floor, it's going to shatter. So we need to improve the toughness of that blade. But we also still want to retain the edge and keep it hard. So it's a fine balance. The higher the temperature you do in the temper, the tougher your blade will be, but at the same time you lower the HRC. These are also not a linear curve. Many steels will have a curve to show you this and what hardness you can expect from different tempering temperatures. Since we're talking about relatively low temperatures, 500 degrees Fahrenheit max, this is easily done in a regular kitchen oven. Heat treating ovens are excellent for this, but it takes them hours to cool down, so keep that in mind. Some people use smaller toaster ovens, but you need to be careful with these. Sometimes they have a wild range in their temperatures. Even though you set it to 400, it could go from 375 to 425. It's always recommended to preheat whatever oven you use before you put your blade in. That way it's less likely to overshoot your desired temperature. It's also always recommended to do two-hour cycles at whatever temp you want. This ensures a full tempering cycle. And guys, you can dunk it in water between temper cycles. You don't need to let it cool to black and still air. Just go dunk it in water. It's not going to hurt it. It's not going to crack. Also, there's no such thing as over-tempering. If you leave your knife in the oven accidentally and fall asleep overnight, it's fine, as long as it didn't change the temperature. Here's what I use during the temper. This is two pieces of angle iron that I've kind of put two bolts in to keep something straight, because sometimes things can warp during the temper, so this is just insurance for me. It also has more mass to protect the blade from overheating. And now let's talk about fixing a warp. What you see pictured is a 3-point straightening jig. It's got two little pins that I can move back and forth depending on the size of the knife or where I want to straighten, and the bolt just applies pressure from the opposite end. It's pretty simple, and I can place this whole thing in the oven. With this method, you can just apply pressure, temper, check the warp, and just keep repeating as many times as you need to correct the warp. Sometimes when discussing tempering a blade, you'll hear people talk about color. Normally you want a straw color. If it's blue or purple, it's usually way too hot. But color alone is not a good measure. There can be oil, especially after a quench. I don't typically clean mine after the quench, so there's oil and fingerprints and all kinds of stuff on it. So color is really not a good way. Sometimes you might have a blade that won't fit in your oven, like a sword. In these cases, you can temper with a torch, but I don't recommend it. In my recent katana video, I showed how to oil temper, and that's much more reliable. So let's talk about stainless steels. It's also a question I see all the time. Can I use a forge for stainless steels? No, you cannot. They really need a zero oxygen environment, so you really need a heat treating oven because you need to put the blade in stainless steel foil, and that gives you your zero oxygen environment. There's also a cryo step, or cryogenically freezing the knife. Basically, what you're doing is reducing the temperature of the steel even more. Right after the quench, you're going to put it either into liquid nitrogen or dry ice and leave it there for a couple hours. This may improve hardness, sometimes up to 3 HRC, depending on the steel. Obviously, liquid nitrogen is really, really cold, but it's also really expensive. And you'll get 2/3 of the way there with dry ice. You can actually get some benefit from your regular home freezer, despite what some people might say. So now, I'll show you guys my heat treating recipes. I'm not going to talk through these, but you guys can pause them and have a deeper look. I hope you got something out of today's video, folks. Lots of important information about heat treating. So save it, bookmark it, share it with your friends. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.